you advise a company? You can advise in a Corfin model, what we have been talking about. You can advise many things in a company. First, you can advise on the share repurchase strategy. Then you can advise on debt to EBITDA. That would be based on how a company's debt to EBITDA multiple would move, because ultimately you have got projection of the company. Then you can also advise on the other return on capital method, whether a dividend increase or a share repurchase increase. That's a broad sense of talking about for those share repurchase. And the leverage part, you can also advise on the convertible debt part, because you have this engine which will give you share price. So anything that talks about a default trajectory for the share price is something that you would do. Now, where could this analysis go wrong, or what are the drawbacks in the share price that I just talked about? The drawback is that all the equity analysts or all the consensus is an upward moving. So if you go beyond a point, you can say that, okay, after 5 years, we can say the company would go at 5%. You don't have the exact estimate. But again, that 5% sales growth is a bit ambitious. So you have to be careful while you use these kind of a data and tweak them. So we can do analysis of share repurchase, the debt policy. We can do analysis regarding the convertible bonds. So those would be analysis. The other analysis that we could do is merger and acquisition. And it's interesting to note that if you merge a company, you need to find out how much extra cash do you have. Will taking on the debt create some trouble for you? So in that aspect, if you take more debt, then you have to project how your debt would look like. Now those things would depend on the assumptions that you are taking for the company that you are merging. So again, you have to play around with the multiples, EV/EBITDA multiples and things like that. So taking a weighted average of the multiple and doing things like that would help you find out whether that merger or acquisition is taking you in a lot of debt that you ideally don't want to go. So these are few analyses that you can do as a Corfin team.
In this part, I'm going to discuss about the sell side investment banking. I'm focusing here more towards the advisory part, where banks often give advice on various aspects like capital structure, share repurchase, merger and acquisitions, or doing any other thing with the excess cash that the companies are having. So it's interesting to note that if a company is having excess cash, where would it reallocate that? One way is to return that back to the shareholders, but again, in the return perspective, there could be special dividend, special repurchase programs. Now, theoretically, what we have been observing in the return of capital mechanism is that if you do a repo or if you do a dividend, it will not make much of a difference. But when you go deep into this and when you understand how you're going to do repo, then it comes about the different share repurchase tactics that you might take. So you might take a share repurchase tactic where you make some particular algorithm on when and how you're going to buy those shares. You could use the normal exchange, or you could use dark pools to actually get a better deal. So a lot of interesting thing could be done from your excess cash, or when you take a stand that you're going to change your capital structure. So the first element is to look at the peers, like what the peers are doing. So if I were to just add a few points here, let me do that for you. So the first would be what peers are doing, peers in the same sector. The second thing would be to draw a multiple regression or some kind of an analysis on how return or leverage affects your multiple, because if something can increase your multiple, you are better off. And the final would be projecting your balance sheet for the next 5 years. The other interesting thing could be like interest rate movements, or taking a fixed versus floating debt, or would be like a convertible debt, or other aspects. So the primary three steps that you require here is to first look at peers in the same sector, get understanding on how various aspects would change your multiple. Now it might be possible that if you increase leverage, your multiple would go down. If that is the trend, then you should be careful about that. So, and then the final aspect is projecting the balance sheet. Just to remind you, projecting balance sheet for next 3 to 5 years. That seems a sensible number. And once you have that, you are in a situation to talk about the leverage level of peer, what return of capital they are employing, where does the multiple stand, and things like that. And then basically, you could look at various aspects. So let me move some things there. Topics would be interest rate movement, convertible debt. It could be tactical share repurchase. And the first step is also as peers in the same sector or peer analysis. So this becomes a few part here. So we are looking at advisory part, advisory on coffin matters. So that's my goal here. That's the whole thesis. I'm going to get more ideas here and look at the trends, what's going on in the market, maybe in some time. So I'll end this video here. Thank you for looking at this small part.
So when we look at the three parts, as I've been talking about, multiple linear regression, rank, and the Monte Carlo simulation, we find out that the correlation, the rank correlation, is at a point in time. The MLR is backward looking, where you say that okay, historically these things have defined the multiple. Maybe we are in a new regime, so that multiple regression equation would not work. And we are using the Monte Carlo engine, and we are using this into the Excel, as I have been talking about, because we have advantage. We are doing a lot of approximation. We want to keep things transparent. If you go to a client and we want to show our Excel model, we can still explain them. How would we explain a very tough R code, which is a black box? And create ambiguity. So that is one reason why we move into Excel. I'm now sticking to the correlation part, which is like point in time, which is like what's seen today, which is contrary to the other part, where multiple regression equation, where we would go for last 40 quarters of 8 companies. But we are sticking at all those 8 companies. So we have relatively less points here. We have 8 companies, and we'll try to add more proxies here. We'll not try to add more proxies back on those multiple linear regression equation, because we were not short of points. We are short of points here because we have 8 companies, so rank correlation in that 8 companies is more sensible. So we have got two choices of correlations that we can use. We can either use a Spearman correlation, or we can use a Pearson correlation. Both have their advantages. But we want to really remove these outliers. As I told you, we are keeping things very simple, so rank correlation would work. So we have a Spearman correlation function, not given in Excel, so we'll probably build that and we will use that in this. So when we say that in this lens chart or whatever chart you are making, when we say that a company's multiple is correlated, it has a 0.8 correlation with payout, so increasing the payout would affect this much. So this is a simpler analysis, and the reason why we are doing all three, the reason why we are doing point in time and past, because each analysis has got its own advantages. When I was talking about the multiple linear regression equation, it was from the past, so a lot of disturbance. Some of the other steps here. The Monte Carlo simulation engine is called a soft Monte Carlo simulation. The reason for that is that we have got just last 10 years of history. So we have got like 40 quarters, and the quarters that we are projecting are 20. So we are only virtually adding the disturbance from the Monte Carlo simulation, and that is the reason why we would de-seasonalize the data, because seasonal changes are not really the disturbance, and they don't really add to the volatility. So the de-seasonalization part based on the quarters are important. So the formula for de-seasonalization would look something like you'll give weights of seasonal index. So sales in a particular year divided by the average sales of the year. Sorry, sales in a particular quarter divided by the average sales of the year. That would give you the seasonal index. Now we'll use this seasonal index to project the future and also clean the data before calculating the alpha and the beta, which is the slope and the intercept. But we are not going to use the slope, which is the beta, for our projections, because we would be using the numbers given to us by consensus. So in that respect, we are mixing the Monte Carlo simulation engine, which is a soft Monte Carlo because the points are less. We are just using AR1. We'll mix that with the projection. So ultimately what we are getting is a very simple and easy to understand model that would give us around 100 or 1000 paths of how the things would go in the future. So in that respect, this is a soft Monte Carlo simulation. It's not that hard, and the beauty lies in the simplicity of this model. It's just AR1. Well, we'll say that the disturbance of a quarter is, the result of a quarter is dependent on the last quarter, and we'll add those disturbance. So in that respect, this is a relatively simple model that we are going to use.
Look to?
More into what's going to be there in the Monte Carlo simulation. So the Monte Carlo simulation starts with pulling values from a server. Now there are troubles while we pull values from the server. The biggest trouble that we get is integrity of the data. Many of the time servers like CapIQ, FactSet, Bloomberg, they don't have data for those quarters that we are looking for. So we need to make sure that either we take a rollover value or we just ignore that setup into our engine. So one way is to just ignore that setup through our engine, or take a rollover value. For both would work, because in fact we have got just last 10 years of data, which would translate into just 40 data points from the past. When we have all the data, then our next work would start with cleaning this data. That would start with removing seasonality, removing trend, and then regressing it, and then adding back seasonality and adding back trend. So those are the steps that we are looking for. Now, while we do all these things, we have to make sure that we get them and make sure that our future balance sheet matches, so that whatever we are predicting makes sense and they go along with the rules that we have in the accounting. So if you are projecting a multiple of a company, then you need to project the EV by EBITDA multiple with EBITDA, so that you can finally get the EV. Now, when you have the EV, the debt of the company, that's not a stochastic thing, that's a policy making thing. So in general, we know the default path for the company to pay back their debt. So in that case, we can get to the market value of the company and market value of equity. And from that market value of equity, we can derive the common share price. But to do that, we need the number of shares. And the number of shares is something that would change if we build up our model and change things into the future. So if you are taking any default strategy for repurchase of these shares, then the number of shares would increase and that would get affected. Now there is a drag that you would see that would go along and along. So that drag would be because all the time consensus estimates are upward moving, and there have been reports which says that all consensus estimates in top in world, all the sales, they are a bit more than what actually it could be. So that's a drag, and that's a place of caution. The other work that we might find trouble is the transform. So we have two aspects. We have the volatility that would be very high, but we would take the volatility, and there is some stat involved in it, in this, that you cannot take non-stationary elements. So we would take a log of the values, or the return of those values, or the return on the sales. We'll run a multiple regression on those returns and then project those returns. So in a short way, we can take log transform, and then we can take a multiple linear regression, and then we can de-transform this log transform. So we can take a log of 10 and then do a de-transformation. Now there have been something that you can take a regression, or you can do these things with time series stationary. That's stationary. You cannot do things with non-stationary. The random number should be independent, IIR, identically and independently distributed, and things like that. But since I've been telling you that our whole goal of this simulation would be just to get that spread of volatility that would be spreading along in the coming years. So our guess is not exactly in the direction, but it's in the spread. So how would we use this spread, or how would we use this volatility? It could be used in finding out whether a company breached a particular debt to EBITDA policy. So if you are advising a company on the debt level or what they should do, so you can talk about that, what would happen if they go on to the default trajectory and how their debt could change. So to do that, you need to make sure that you have all the assumption for the company so that you can do a default trajectory for that company. You might have sales for that company, but you might not have many other data. You have to find out what's their share repurchase policy, what's their other policy. And based on that, you can use the engine to find out the debt to EBITDA path. And that's really important when you talk about a rating downgrade or what kind of rating they are looking at. So all of these things depend on your starting point, which is the data, ending point, which is the path. And in between, you have to make sure that you follow those accounting principles so that things don't break up. So in an accounting principle, your balance sheet should match. So you have to project each and every part of the balance sheet. Interesting to see is that when you create a pro forma balance sheet, the Monte Carlo parts would give you a value, and you'll take a mean of those parts in your balance sheet. So when you change these parts, your path 0 or the average value would make the balance sheet match, but your path 1, 2, 3, 4 to 999, if you are taking 1000 path, they would not match. So in that regard, your paths won't be stable in terms of balancing part, but that's fair enough. This is an assumption that we would like to go for. So this is about the engine and how you are going to use that. For those quarters, so each time Q4 gives more sales, Q2 gives less sales, which does not really add to the volatility, but that's already priced into the system. So we would like to remove the seasonality. One other step that we would like to do, which is a bit tricky here, tough to understand intuitively at the first go, which is detrending. We would detrend the data, because the trend that we are going to add would be from the consensus estimate or the equity research report. So we would first detrend, deseasonalize, create the alpha, search for the alpha and beta. We'll use the beta that is given to us from the respective coverage teams, and we'll project. So the first two steps here are deseasonalization and detrending, which we'll go into more details and I'll show you how that is done.
The next thing that we want to look at is to balance complexity with simplicity. Now there is a lot of quant involved, and many of the analysts or many of people who work in this area don't like excess complexity, because one thought says that the more simple it is, the more intuitive it is, the more it makes sense. So we are looking at Excel versus VBA versus R. Let me add a little part. So mastery of data table is something, because we would have like 50 data tables. Okay, let me put down the scale here. So what we might deal with here, okay, what are we dealing with? What are we dealing with? What are the options we have? What X complexity in Excel? Okay, this might be a little easier to understand. So what do we want to run? We want to run multiple linear regression using linest function. And not using C#. C# or R, we are not going to use that. So So we want to run multiple linear regression. So this is, this line actually goes on for everything. And why we are going to use Excel? Because everybody wants to see what's going on. Everyone should be able to decrypt. So what we have here, we have some Monte Carlo simulation, we have multiple regression, we have rank correlation, we have Kolsky transform and eigenvalue. Ignore the fourth one if that sounds not so good. What are the options we have? We have Excel, we have VBA, we have R. Now the main idea is that everybody should be able to decrypt. So, and we would like to keep more of the things in Excel, less in VBA, and very less in C# or R, because ultimately if you want to change anything, if you want to tweak anything, if you want to have a close look at what's happening, the Excel becomes a very easy thing for everybody to look at. Somebody from a coverage team or a CEO wants to look at your model, and you have that model developed in C# or R. How you're going to explain to him? So in advisory, keeping things simple is most important. And that's the reason for this slide. But you might have a lot of data tables that you that would compute these paths, and you would have a big file with many paths of Monte Carlo simulation. So what do we want to run? So we have financials of the company. So we have financials of the company, we are looking at running some analysis for that. So we would use Excel, we would use VBA just to make those small functions. Again, that would help us to keep a data table. So we'll get support for mastery of data tables, support from VBA and not running it from VBA. So that's what we are looking for, and that's what's going to help us, because if you make those excess things go to VBA, it might be difficult to decrypt for somebody who is a CEO or a CFO or a company or somebody who is a sector specialist. So this also talks about the importance of Excel. So although personally speaking, if I were to play around with things, I like complexity. So I would go with a C# or a R. That gives me very interesting ideas and deep insight, scalability, more accuracy, the chances of human error being reduced. A lot of advantages do exist in moving to C# or R, but when you are in the advisory field, when you're going to make people understand about some of the ideas that you have in your mind, then Excel becomes most important.
So the simulation also depends on the sector that we are talking about. If we are looking at some technology sector, you will see that there is a lot of growth in that sector. That sector is booming more today than ever. If we talk about the defense sector, it was booming in the time of 2002 to 2005. At this time, it's coming down. When we talk about the healthcare sector, again, it's booming. When we talk about the consumer sectors like food and retail, these are also booming. So the sector would also define what kind of a simulation we are going to use. So I'm coming back to the older idea of how we are going to look at things. So when we look at things, we have got present. We have got some data extract that we can get from the past, and we have present and the past and the projection of the future. So when we look at present, we are fixing this frame of time. So we are going to see what's happening today. So what is the company's leverage in the sector as compared to its multiple? So is there a linkage between a highly levered company with their high multiple or things like that? Or is there a relation between how much dividend a company is paying based on their leverage or their sales growth or their output? So we are fixing a frame today, and we are going to first look at what's in this frame for easier understanding. The next step would be we would go back. We will use a multiple linear regression equation to find out what is defining a company's leverage and EV multiple. That would be step 2. And step three would be, we are going to use present, past, and we are going to project future to find out how a company's sales would look like using the Monte Carlo engine. So we are basically dividing the analysis into three sections that would make our work easy, and it will make things very clear. When you look at how a multiple is defined for a sector, you have to be very careful. So if you are making a multiple linear regression equation for how a multiple is defined in a sector, that equation would be very similar to the entire sector. So if you talk about the technology sector and you build an MLR and you say that in the MLR industry, companies have multiple ranging from 10 to 15, maybe five out of that 15 or one third is explained by leverage, or one third is explained by sales. Some part is explained by distribution. So if a company tweaks in a distribution, that would raise up its multiple and in turn raise up its price. So that's where it becomes interesting. So this is the entire 360 degree view, where we have present, past, and the future in our analysis. So when we look at the other things, we have to understand in details on how a multiple linear regression equation would work on Excel, and why we are switching to Excel, why we are not using SAS R. So one of the reasons here is that when we want to select something, there are many factors that we would like to consider. The first factor is the sign of the slope. So we cannot say that sales growth is increasing a company's, decreasing a company's multiple. So negative signs of sales growth and a multiple does not make sense. So for linear regression equation, and there could be many. So in Excel, there are like 16. And you can have 2 to the power 6 combination, 2 to the power 16 combination or permutations that would work around, because you can select just 1, just 2, just 3. When you select 3, you can have 3C2, so it's an equation of NC0, NC1, NC2, NC3 upon NCN. So 16C0, 16C1, 0 does not make sense because ultimately you are selecting one dependent. We'll have 16C1, 16C2, and when you sum this all, it would be like 2 to the power 16. So we can have 2 to the power 16, and getting this into a simulation engine and making all those steps, like which factors you don't want negative, if the contribution of something is very large. Say suppose the S&P is explaining a multiple to 18, and the other factors are like -1, -1, -1, or very small, then we would probably remove that part. So we'll have constraints. I am talking about these constraints one by one. The first constraint here is that if you have a multiple of a company that is say 15, if Google is trading at an EV by EBITDA multiple of 15, you would probably take a multiple regression equation where these contributions are correct in their proportion, as well as they are correct in their signs. So therefore you cannot make this engine very very algorithmic kind of, because you still want to choose. So you'll still want to have those true false, so that you can tick on and see how the multiple regression is going. The important part here is that you want to make sure the contribution is reasonable, you want to make sure the size, the signs of these coefficients are reasonable, you want to make sure the R-square is good enough. So when you make all of these, you can say that okay, 16 EV by EBITDA multiple of Google, it's explained 5 units by sales growth, 3 units by return of capital, 2 units by leverage, 3 units by market, or how S&P is going to behave, so that you can sensitize your model and you can say that okay, if I increase, if the market goes up 10%, sales remains as it is, then how is their multiple going to change, and how is their share price going to change. It's a backward looking model, not a future looking model, so you cannot still predict the future price. But and also this is through the cycle, so you cannot predict this model, or you cannot use this to trade to actually take a trading bet, because you don't know which point you are at in the cycle. So not useful for trading, but very good where you want to explain a company how, what would happen if they increase their sales, what would happen if they increase their leverage, what would happen if they increase their payout ratios, increase their dividend, and things like that. Now if you again look closely at this multiple linear regression equation, it will have inputs which are of like last 40 quarters of say 8 companies which are very similar. So in this 8 companies, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, you might have a Google, Microsoft, Oracle, or these kind of companies, and you will have a sector view of how the multiples in this sector are explained, so that and you can have a cash here as well. So you can say that if you have got a lot of cash, maybe you can return it back, and this is the effect that's going to look at your EV by EBITDA multiple. And of course this would turn out into PE ratios as well, which is a more famous ratio in this regard. For multiple linear regression model that we would use, So we have to select various variables. The linest function in Excel gives you power to select around 16 variables at a time. Now, based on the sector, you will have a set of equation for that sector, which you can use for different companies. But again, you have to be careful here. So a backtest would be like if you say a multiple is defined by leverage, return on capital, and S&P or the market return. Then you can backtest that and see how that has been performing. But at the same time, you have today's number. So if you have 8 peers, you can talk about how your regression equation talks about a multiple and how it is defined for these 8 companies. This would give an insight on how to increase the multiple, what factors contribute most to the multiple. If we can tweak onto that, maybe market will reward us more multiple. It's a bit quant strategy. If you can link it with a lot of logic and understanding about that sector, about those companies, you can help the clients to increase their EV by EBITDA multiple. So you have to select and deselect. Now selection and deselection becomes quite tricky. Sometimes you don't get really the good equation that you are looking for. As I told you, there are challenges in selecting those numbers. So you'll first deselect everything. You'll select the one which is highly correlated in the same direction. So you can take 3 steps. Either you can select everything, 16 most important or the best. You can keep on deselecting them based on the p-values, or you can deselect everything and select the one which has got the highest correlation. So these are 2 set of equations. Now a problem comes that when you select everything which has got good p-values, all are significant, but the r-square falls down. So that becomes tricky. So in that aspect, you have got 2 or 3 hidden trial methods. Probably you, if you are like taking on the return on capital aspect, you can take total return upon net income, or total return upon sales, or total return upon EBITDA, and search for the best numbers that fit there. So you can change those shades, but you have to be careful about 2 things. The p-values should make everything significant, and your R-square should be good. Anything about like 50% is good to go, since you have got very less number here. So you can go for a forward selection, a backward selection, a selection where you do some hit and trial, a selection where you go both up and down. And there are ways to select the best regression points, but whatever you do, it should make a business sense. The contribution should be right. So other than the R-square, the p-value, the contribution of that that factor should be good enough. So like if you select S&P and you see that 14 units out of 15 units of the multiple is explained by S&P, you think that probably this is not the right way to go. So you'll have a macro set, you'll have a set of the companies, you'll have a growth set, you'll have a risk set, you'll have a market risk like volatility of S&P, volatility of sales. So you'll have various sets where you can plug and choose equation, and probably you can come out with 2 or 3 multiple linear regression equation that makes most sense. So a company can gauge which risk is moving down its multiple. The company can also gauge which risk would move up its multiple. Is it more debt? Is it more return? Is it more growth? On and how these sheets come into picture. So this is a multiple linear regression that would take, like, if you have 8 peers and you go for 10 years, so you have 40 points for each of these companies. So 40 into 8, you have got 320 data points that you can use, compared to a rank correlation where you have just today's number. So this is one way to configure the MLR setup. We have Excel and VBA to do our analysis. We have 3 sections of the analysis. I've been repeating a bit part. So backward looking is the multiple linear regression. The current frame is about the rank correlation, and future is about Monte Carlo. I'm going to talk about how we are going to use VBA in a very efficient manner, in a very smart manner, to do 2 things. First, keep as many things in Excel as possible. Second, reduce the chances of error that we can have, and the landing of those, landing into those blue screens. So our goal is not to shorten down things, not to make things go fast, but our goal is to keep things simple. Our goal is to keep things less into VBA. Our goal is to keep intuitive things into Excel, because you can do a lot of analysis there. So you, if you need another chart somewhere, you can probably go into Excel. If you are not there, if our programmer is not there, or MATLAB programmer is not there, there is an option. The other problem is plan out all those things, give it to somebody who will develop this into C#, get those add-ins, install that into Excel and do. But again, that is a little tricky, because I don't prefer those black boxes, and the clients don't prefer those black boxes. Some of the person who don't like programming also don't prefer those black boxes. It's a good learning when you have all the things into Excel. You can look at the p-value, selection, deselection of things, rather than are doing you just a multiple linear regression equation that is your solution. So that is one reason. Now we are going to understand in this part how to look at VBA. So VBA has got subroutine and functions. We'll prefer functions, we'll not prefer subroutines. The reason for that is that subroutines are used for doing some heavy work. Probably in the Monte Carlo engine we might move to them. But again, we are going to use those subroutines to create those third dimensions in the data table and not really to run the analysis. So still VBA is used as a toolkit in spite we are using it. And the idea is to use more functions of VBA rather than going into the subroutine. Subroutine are powerful, they can do damage, they cannot be controlled. And another problem of subroutine, suppose you have got a file and you are sharing that file, many people are sharing that file. You want to run a code. Now if you have got a subroutine embedded into that file, that is a bit tricky. So keeping an add-in and rotating that add-in is a bit easy. So you'll have an Excel add-in that you can prefer over a .m file, because the code in .m file is tough to update, and you can have that add-in being rotated and that add-in will help everybody. You can add all the custom functions that you require there. So to add the third dimension into the data table, you will use something called join and split, which would take a snapshot of capture the values in a cell, join them in a single cell using a delimiter and throw it out. So when you refresh this data table artificially, or when you refresh using a Shift F9, you want a third dimension of data to be captured. So for that, you'll use this join split kind of a framework. This is again made into a VBA function. The other framework that you can use into the VBA is the rank correlation framework, because the PSR correlation, the default correlation, the CORR function in Excel, that is a bit tricky because it will skew the analysis if you have got an extreme entry. The rank correlation is better in this part, that even if there is a very high entry, it will give it a rank. So you'll have a rank like 1, 3, 4, 5, 7, 2, 3, 1, 2, 4, and you'll find a correlation between those ranks rather than finding out correlation between those numbers. This would become important because when you have got less number of points, and when you know that you are going to get Y points because you have just 8 companies on your list, because you're looking at a point in time frame, so you need to make sure that you remove those extreme values from the system. So rank correlation and split, those are the two basic engines of doing the analysis. The Monte Carlo engine in the Excel would be run by data tables. We won't get a lot of things into data table, rather we will just use things like switching things off and on. So suppose you want to find out the contribution in volatility from each factor. You have got volatilities in sales, you have got volatilities in multiple, you have got volatilities in share price, and a lot of volatilities inherently in the past that you see. You want to find out how that is contributing to the final volatility of the final outcome that you are showing. So you will put on and off each of these stochastic process. Now this is a heavy word, stochastic, although it is nothing but AR1 simulation, so probably you can avoid that word or should not be getting scared for that word. We'll put this on and off, and just to put this on and off, we'll use a data table, and just to click on that data table, we'll use VBA. So we could do all of this into VBA in probably a code to get the directory values, but those would be hard-coded values. Any error there would not be easy to check. So in that respect, you and this is called the risk attribution. Like if you have got a 10% volatility in a share price, how much this is attributed to different factors, and the final would be a diversification factor when all of these things would come together to you. So this risk attribution analysis, you can do it into VBA or R, but in Excel it's much easy. The updation part is easy when you take it to somewhere and he says that show me the analysis, or switch things on and off, and it becomes easy for us. So in that respect, we are going to use VBA very strategically just to manage those data tables. Quantitative corporate finance, we see that the analysis also depends on the sector that we are covering. So for example, if we are covering a technology sector, those companies are cash rich. Seen what analysis we do, we have seen the importance of Excel here. Personally speaking, I don't like Excel because it's very hard to work with. It hangs a lot, big files create trouble. Now what I could do in 2 minutes, it takes half an hour to do in Excel because I don't know what problem peeps in. Sometimes the file gets hanged, sometimes there is a misshoot, or those kind of trouble. So when I learn everything as a developer, as somebody who knows in and out of everything of the models, probably I would like R or MATLAB, because we just click a button and do that and I'll create my checks. But the reason why we are using Excel is because there is a big team that wants to look into. Suppose you want to send this projection to the equity team or to the equity research guy who want to get his comments or something like that. You want to give this to your colleague or your senior. They can't go into the R code. Installing R at their end is tricky, but you can still keep them into the pipe. So VBA becomes very important here, because VBA will make things stick at the Excel. So the better you are at VBA programming and the strategically you make those VBA code makes life very easy. So one strategy that we are going to follow is that we will avoid subroutines. We'll use functions. We'll keep things as much as Excel. So probably by writing just 4 lines of a VBA code, I could reduce my file size from 20 to 10 MBs, but that would come at the cost of a black box that is being created. So I won't like that. But if there is something that we cannot do into Excel, which is not scalable enough in the Excel, like rank correlation part, I'm probably doing to the VBA, but I'll have my checks as well. So in VBA, I have to be careful. The error handling of VBA is poor. You have to make sure that you install an external error handling system. You need to make sure that you need to think of all errors that could happen, like a range name not found, a chart not found, and so on. So you need to keep your eyes open, but this comes at an advantage that many people can use your analysis. So it's a pain at your end, but a gift to others. But that's where the Excel part becomes important. So some of the things in VBA that could increase the dimensions of your analysis, and this is an important part here. So if you are looking at data tables that are used extensively in Monte Carlo simulation in Excel, you have got just two dimensions. You can change just two things. You cannot change those sensitivity parameters to 3. So getting those 3 sensitivity parameters is done by something called a split and a merge function. What this function would do, and it's a pre-built, it's not a pre-built function, so we are going to build this. It's going to collect the elements in the row, concatenate them with a delimiter and paste them in a cell. So you are adding a third dimension to the data table. So earlier when you use a 2D data table, you were just moving around with 2 parameters. Now you can move around with 3 parameters. So you have added a 3 dimension. I'm going to show how powerful this is, because when you want to take a snapshot using the data tables, this part becomes very important. So this third dimension is very important, where VBA would help us to concatenate and then split and throw those things out. That would be very useful for us when we want to create those paths, change. So just imagine what you want to create those paths into the future. You want those 1000 paths. So what you have changing, you have got changing number of time, you have got changing number of paths. This is 2 dimension. A third dimension that is added into the background is all those financials of the company. Now I could do this very easily in an R or in MATLAB by getting a 3D matrix or playing around with stuff. That would come at the cost of this abstraction layer that just got removed. So if there is some error, if there is some trouble, if there is some tweaking required, if you want to show different scenarios, if you want to customize that to a custom scenario, say suppose your client wants a very specific application, or they say that okay, don't assume these parameters, just change my parameters, you're not going to run that in R there and then and change that in Excel. The person who is presenting, the person who is with us, with will be more comfortable to do that, and the client is more comfortable when you see all those data. You can quickly create a chart right ahead there. So those are the kind of advantages where a corporate finance investment banking team, when it goes to Google, it can still show them what they are thinking of. So the importance of Excel and VBA is deep. It's very deep, and the advantages are immense. Like our leverage teams, like for example, if they like our convert strategy, or if that convert strategy is linked to those scenarios where share repurchase is being taken care of, or things like that, we get the loans being given to those companies. We have the working of a broker that we would do for the share repurchase strategies. So this is really one of the topmost things that we would like to do. So in this regard, share repurchase is an interesting thing to look at. Now our engine would be to project the future of the company, because that's where the share repurchase would happen. So So we are projecting on how to do the share repurchase for the next 5 years or 20 quarters. In this regard, we need to project how the company's balance sheet and the financials would look like. And here comes an important part, because since we want to do share repurchase in an active manner based on the falling of share price or based on multiple falling or based on some other strategy, like in three quarters the multiple was falling or the share price was falling, or any custom strategy that we want to build, we need to have snapshot of the future, each snapshot quarter 1, 2, 3, 4 of the future, and that would help us to build this share repurchase strategies. Now inherently there is a lot of controversy about the share repurchase strategies, but I'm going to just move around and talk a little bit on them. So the first strategy that we can do in share repurchase is share price falling below a particular price, or share price falling consecutively in 3 quarters. So that means that the market is not bullish in our company, or the market is not interpreting growth in our company, which we as a company thinks we have. So we can make a strategy and give it to the bank that, okay, when the share price falls, do the share repurchase. The other strategy would be price to earning multiple. Whenever the price to earning multiple falls, we might believe that we are undervalued, so we can take a share repurchase and we can implement them. So that's price to earning. Now we don't really know where would this price to earning multiple go into the future. It's possible that this might go in a zigzag manner or come down or move up, depending on the analysis that we are building up using those Monte Carlo simulation, using the past, using the consensus estimate, using our discussion with the people who cover these companies and so on. So in that respect, we will find out where the price to earning multiple is going. So we'll have price to earning multiple, share price fall, and a lot more interesting strategies. So we can have a strategy that do excess repo after this amount. That would be like excess repo. Or we can have do a constant repo of this amount. Or we can have the two strategies like share price fall, and many innovations can be made in share price. So there are two inherent things where a pop-in team would help you, especially in those projection part. A team that understands the financials of the company, a team that understands how different aspects of risk attributions happen at that company, how sensitive a company's share price is to return of capital, to leverage. A team that handles all this part can help a company to get along and take the best share repurchase strategy. The next part was this engine could be used, this convertible bond, because once you have those share price projection into the future, you can find out how good idea is a convert bond option. Because if you sell a convertible bond, if you believe that the share price is not so bullish, and buying a convertible bond is giving you more return, maybe you are paying less interest out of that, or even after buying those hedges, those big hedges for those conversions to stop the dilution of your equity, even after doing that, if you get, or to find out the price of the hedge or how much you must hedge, things like that involves a projection of your balance sheet into the future. So in this respect, a pop-in team is very helpful, and it would help you on share repurchase and this. And as we have been talking about, our focus is client. So when a bank goes to some company, the bank wants to keep things simple, because otherwise the person whom you are going to is not understanding a lot of things out of this platform. Looking at two multiples here. The first multiple is EV by EBITDA multiple. The other multiple is debt to EBITDA multiple. Two most crucial multiple that would come out as an output of our engine. Now this engine, again, we have talked about why to use Excel for this engine. This engine is important also because when you talk about these balance sheet and these numbers, you might get accounting information there. So somebody who's very good into programming might not be so good into accounting, who can make sure that things match. So again, that is an advantage that we have while being into Excel and not moving into a C# or other kind of an idea. So we have two important multiples here. The first multiple is debt by EBITDA multiple. That is important because that's how your rating downgrade would happen. So most of the rating downgrade weights close to the debt by EBITDA multiple and how it's going to move. The other multiple is how the market is pricing you. That's EV by EBITDA multiple. That multiple is being awarded to you by the market. So if your EV by EBITDA multiple is moving along, that would drag along your share price. So EBITDA is something that is a best proxy for cash, and EV by EBITDA multiple is something that you are going to look at. Now, while your projection of Monte Carlo simulation, you have got many things that you could do. you can take a constant EV by EBITDA multiple, or you can shake that up. In case you shake this EV by EBITDA multiple, then you have to make sure how you shake it up. The reason why this becomes tricky is because you have projections for many elements, but you don't have projections for EV by EBITDA. You have projections for EBITDA. So you're going to shake and try to stick to aspects where you can get the projection to make sure that you don't do anything that's not inconsistent, or your Monte Carlo simulation is stable. So in that respect, you're going to shake sales, you're going to shake EBITDA, you can shake other aspects, but you should not shake things which you cannot talk about. So that's the reason researching on EV by EBITDA multiples becomes important. And as I have been talking in the three frames, the current frame, the past and the future, that you are analyzing a lot of things. So the past EV by EBITDA multiple, how it's dependent on various factors in the sector, and the future and the present, both of them will play an important role. If you think there is a logical number that you can think of, you can make sure, or you can take an average and make sure that EV by EBITDA comes down to that average slowly. So that's one approximation that you could do to make your analysis stable. So regarding the multiples, the EV by EBITDA multiple and the debt by EBITDA multiple are two most important multiples that we are going to look at.